So very good morning to all the participants. So now we are going to start with our very first session, that is embedded systems and embedded processes. As we all know that our day-to-day life is becoming more and more dependent on this embedded technologies and digital techniques. Embedded technologies are bonding into our daily activities even without our knowledge. So the fact is that the refrigerator, washing machine, microwave ovens, DVD players, smart televisions, they are all built around some embedded systems. Some of you may be traveling through some luxurious vehicles or through some modern vehicles. So genius players are working behind the special features offered by these vehicles to us. Like if we are talking about the luxurious vehicle like BMW, then vehicles from Ford, you know, Ford company, or from that Honda. So special features are provided by these companies to us, right? And they are varying from ignition control system to intelligent headlamp controllers. Then we can have engine control systems, then airbag control system, which will protect us from some severe accident, right? So they are nothing but they are intelligent embedded systems only, if we talk about the automobile industries. So in general, what we can say about the embedded systems? Embedded systems are just like some reliable servants. They are just sitting at some hidden place and they are dedicated to their task till their last breath. These tasks are maybe assigned by their users, by their bosses, maybe by us also, right? So they are just sitting at some hidden place and trying to execute all those services which are assigned to them. So in this session, we will talk about the overview of embedded systems, then embedded processor, and major domains where they are used, right? So first of all, what is the definition of embedded system? Embedded system is an electronic or electromechanical device which may be dedicated to some task, and it is a combination of both hardware and software. Right, so embedded system is a combination of this hardware and software. Now, what is hardware? What comprises in this hardware unit? It requires some processor in order to process some input information, right? And the software is the application software, or sometimes it is also known as firmware. Or it is the application software which is required for the execution of that particular hardware. So in any embedded system, if we are talking about the hardware component may be your processor. And if we are talking about the processor, it may be a general purpose processor, that is GPP, or domain specific processor, right? So, and the software part is the firmware, which is actually required for the execution of that particular hardware. So this is the firmware. Application software is the nothing, but it is a firmware. And in many scenarios, in many applications of embedded systems, the third component also come into the picture, that is real-time operating system, that is RTOS. In many applications, your embedded system is also a combination of these two units, and also third part is also required, that is RTOS, that is real-time operating system. Now, what is real-time operating system? Can anyone tell what is real-time operating system?
That's processing in real-time.
That's
processing in real-time.
Very good. Right? So real-time operating system is that operating system which provides the services to the users within the strict time deadlines. So timing constraint is very important in real-time operating system. Right? So as I have already told you that examples of this embedded system are microwave ovens, refrigerator, DVD player, microwave oven, then modern vehicles like BMW, Mercedes S and BMW 7, mobile phones, all of us are nowadays we are having mobile phones, smart mobile phones, digital camera, computer systems, and many more, right? So main components of embedded systems are hardware, application software, that is firmware, and the third one is the real-time operating system. Now, what is RTOS? RTOS, the main objective of RTOS is to provide the services to the users within strict time deadline, right? Now, what are those services? Those services are like inter-task communication, timers, counters, right? Then dynamic memory allocation between these tasks. All these services are to be defined and managed by this real-time operating system, right? And these are operate in constrained environment, like those environment where memory and speed processing power, they are limited, right? There we can opt for your RTOS. So what is the main component behind that RTOS? That is your kernel. Kernel is the software actually. It is a software part which provides the services to the user, and it is also provide the abstraction layer between the hardware and the software unit, right? So this is a diagram which basically provide the main emphasis towards that RTOS. Basically nothing, but it provides the abstraction layer between the hardware part and the software part, right? Now, the next category is the classification of embedded systems, how they are classified. Right? Embedded systems are classified in main three groups. The first one is the small scale embedded system. Then we can have medium scale embedded system, and then sophisticated embedded system. In many books, they have also mentioned large scale embedded system also. Because they are the same as such as that of sophisticated embedded system. Now, the first one is the small scale embedded system. In small scale embedded system, we can have single 8-bit, like we can have 8051 microcontroller also, single 8-bit or 16-bit microcontroller. In case of 16-bit microcontroller, what we can have? 8051 is your 8-bit microcontroller. And in case of your 16-bit microcontroller, we can have PIC type of microcontroller. And if we require 32-bit type of microcontroller, then your advanced RISC machine, we can have. But for small-scale embedded system, we can have only single 8-bit or 16-bit microcontroller. A little hardware required for its processing. And the firmware or the application software which is required for the execution of that particular hardware. The type of languages which it require for the development of that code is C or Java will be used as the development platform. Various applications which I have shown in this slide are the fan regulator, then soft toys, then we can have digital calendar or any message if we want to show, then we can use such type of small scale embedded system. The next category is medium scale embedded system. In medium scale embedded system, we can have single or few 16 or 32-bit microcontroller. Then DSP processors, RISC, that is reduce instruction set computer. They may also employ the readily available application specific system processor or intellectual property core for the development of such type of embedded applications, and the firmware required may be required C or source code engineering, RTOS and IDE development platform. And the various applications, it may be used in your small robots, right, in your coffee vending machine or small type of smart house. There we can have medium scale embedded system. The third category is the sophisticated embedded system or large scale embedded system. Now, for the development of sophisticated embedded system, we must have reconfigurable devices. Now, what are reconfigurable devices? Reconfigurable devices. Now, what are those reconfigurable devices? Have you ever listen about the term that is PLD devices? PLD devices, that is programmable devices.
Many
times. Yeah, programmable logic devices are the devices which can be programmed according to some given logic. We can program according to some given logic. We can consider it as a black box, and at the input we can have variables, and output we have function of that input variables, and that black box will be considered as your PLD, right? Now PLD are further categorized in three main categories, right? What are those categories? SPLDs, CPLDs, and then FPGAs. SPLDs is simple programmable logic devices. Then we can have complex programmable logic devices, then field programmable gate array. Now, when we are talking about simple programmable logic devices, under this category in SPLDs, we can have AND array and OR array, planes, or we can have plane also. So your PAL, PLA will be fall under the category of this SPLD or generic array logic also. So PAL, PLA, then your generic array logic, they will be fall under the category of SPLD. In CPLDs, what we have your input output blocks. Then what we have your function blocks and programmable switch matrix. These are the three main components or three main blocks which constitutes to this CPLD, that is complex programmable logic devices, right? We can have IO block, function blocks and programmable switch matrix. Now what is this function block? When at this stage we in this case of SPLD we have PAL like block and PLAs also and generic array logic. When some extra circuitry is added to this PAL like block, it will yield to some macro cells, right? It will yield to some macro cells. Now in each function block we can, depending upon the configuration of that device, we can have number of macro cells contained in each function block, right? So number of function, number of macro cells which are contained in function block are the main element which will be acting as your main component in your CPLDs. Okay, so all these function blocks will be surrounded by IO blocks, and all these IO blocks and function blocks are interconnected with the help of programmable switch matrix. Right? Now the third category is FPGA. Now, what is the difference between SPLD and FPGA and CPLDs? The first difference is this, that in case of FPGA, again, it is a combination of three main blocks. That is IO block. First of all, we talk about its similarities between these CPLDs and FPGA, programmable switch matrix. Now, in this case, instead of function block, what we have configurable logic block. As in case of SPLDs, we have function blocks. Whereas in case of FPGA, instead of this function blocks, we are having configurable logic blocks. As in this case, in function blocks, what are the basic component in this function block? Was your macro cell. But in case of your this FPGA, what is the main element of this configurable logic block? Is your lookup tables. Now, have you ever listened about the term Moore's law?
Yes.
Moore's law. Now, what is that law?
Output depends only on the present state.
No.
No, no.
Input and class output.
It's regarding the number of transistors in that.
Yeah. Moore's law actually states that your number of transistors available on a chip gets double after every 1.5 or 2 years. Right? Yeah, so when we are talking about CPLD, how much number of transistors it may contain, how many number of, you can say the basic component it may contain, it will limit up to 1 million in number. Because in case of your FPGA, it will start from 1 million in number. Right? So this is all about your PLDs, that is programmable logic devices. and these two categories may be fall under the category of this reconfigurable devices. So the third category of this embedded system is your sophisticated type of embedded system or large scale embedded system. So here we require enormous hardware for the development of such embedded system, and for that particular embedded system, what type of hardware we require reconfigurable type of device. So in that particular application, it may be use your CPLD or FPGA depending upon the application where we are going to use this type of embedded system. And the firmware which is required for the development of that particular hardware, it may require your VHDL or Verilog, right? And what are the applications where we are using this sophisticated type of embedded systems? Are the robots, service robots, right? Then we can have in metros also, then in your mobile phones. There is also a NASA project, NASA X-38 project. If you search about this project in Google, then in that project, they have developed a boat, rescue boat by the International Space Station in order to save the life of astronauts or the crew members. So for the development of that particular NASA's project, they have used your reconfigurable type of devices at the back end. Okay. So these are the three categories about your embedded system, that is small scale embedded system. Then we have talked about the medium scale embedded system. And then at the third level, we have talked about the large scale or sophisticated type of embedded system. Okay. Now, other applications areas are home automation, very popular today. Everyone wants that his or her home should be automated, right? So as from picture, it is very much clear that as soon as a person opens the door for his home, then LED will be on, AC will be on, so that the room temperature will be at the comfortable level, right? So your this power sensor will be on, reminder sensor, if there are some messages, then it should be get on. Water sensor in order to fill the water tank. Then water shut off valve and attention sensor. These should be coming in the picture as soon as a person opens the door of his or her own home. Then in the automobile industry, as I have talked about the BMW and this Mercedes SMB, BMW 7. So various features are provided by this automobile industry. So around 75 to 100 embedded systems are played at the back end in order to provide such services. Whereas in modern vehicles, like if we are talking about some small type of vehicles, then around 20 to 40 type of embedded systems, they are working at the back end, right? So what are those special features which will be provided by these luxurious vehicles to us? That is the ignition control system, engine control system, then airbag control system. And at the fourth, I have talked about the ignition control system also, and intelligent headlamp controllers also. So these basic features are provided by the embedded systems only. Okay. Now there is another concept, that is system on chip. So system on chip is also very important when we are talking about the embedded system, concept of embedded system. Everything we want to be minimized. Power consumption should be minimum. If we are at the customer end, we require such devices whose power consumption is minimum, whose speed is very high, whose throughput is very high, hai na? Or kya features hume required honge? Other special features? Pardon? Durability. Yeah, reliability. Hai na? So, yeah, battery backup also. So again, the minimum power consumption we required. So when we are talking about the SOC, when we are dealing with SOC, we require that everything should be on a single chip, right? So what a typical SOC consists of? It consists of one or more microcontroller, microprocessor, DSP core, memory blocks as it is main similar to that of a processor. We are talking about the microprocessor or microcontroller architecture, right? So memory blocks, including your selection of ROM, RAM, EEPROM, and flash, timing and control unit are required in order to give the timing and control signal for the execution of the instructions. Then peripheral, including your counter timers, real timers, then analog interfaces, ADCs and DACs, and power voltage regulator should be there. So these are some SoCs example, that is camera on chip, that is available from Bell Labs Corporation, and solar power wireless sensor from Berkeley Corporation. Right, so these are some SoCs example. So whenever we want to convert a given system into a single chip, right, we should go for SoC. So every time it is not possible to construct a SoC for a given system. So when it is not feasible to construct a SoC for a given system, we should go for its alternate, right? So what are those alternate? If it is not feasible to construct an SoC, the other alternative is to develop a SIP or MCM. SIP is system in package, or MCM is multiple chip module. So when it is not feasible to construct a SoC for a given system, we should go for SIP or MCM. So in MCM or SIP, your number of blocks which are contained in your SoC for this particular application, for this SIP, we should have a corresponding chip. So in this SIP or MCM, we are having number of chips which are either stacked either in a vertical fashion or in a horizontal fashion, right? Now all these blocks which are contained in this SoC, they are connected by some buses. Now what are those buses? Should be special, right? So what are those buses? Those buses are AMBA buses, that is Advanced Microcontroller Bus Architecture. They are available from ARM Corporation, that is Advanced RISC. ARM processor is required, your some type of special buses in order to interface between the various blocks. So what are those buses? They are AMBA buses, that is Advanced Microcontroller Bus Architecture. And these same buses are used for providing the connection among the various blocks in the SoC, right? So the Advanced Microcontroller Bus Architecture, they were introduced in the year of 1996 and is widely used as on-the-chip bus for ARM processor. The first AMBA bus was Advanced System Bus, and the second one was your Advanced Peripheral Bus, as an example of SoC based on the MIPS architecture. Right, here MIPS stands for microcontroller without interlocked pipeline structure. Right, so till now what we have discussed about the concept of embedded system, then its classification of embedded system into three main categories, that is small scale, medium scale, and sophisticated embedded system, and the concept of SoC. Right, now the next is your embedded processor. So embedded processor, which we are using in embedded system application, they should be special. Now, what are those special features which should be available with such type of processor? Firstly, they must process the signal, or they must process the information which is available at the input at a fast rate, or that information should be precise, right? So an embedded processor, we can define embedded processor is a special microprocessor or a microcontroller that performs fast, precise, and intensive calculation for complex real-time applications. Right? So example of embedded processors are ARM processor, that is Advanced RISC Machine processor, Intel MMX processor, and MIPS processor. So let's talk one by one. That is, first of all, ARM processor. Here, ARM stands for Advanced RISC Machine. ARM stands for Advanced RISC Machine. Advanced RISC Machine, before to that, it was termed as Acorn RISC Machine, and it is a 32-bit RISC processor. They are provided from the ARM Limited Corporation Company. Now, we can say that about 75% of all embedded applications, they are built around this ARM processor only. Now, what is available in this ARM processor, which attracts the industry, embedded industry, in order to develop such kind of products? So first of all is its power saving feature, right? That is why the ARM CPUs are dominant in the mobile electronics market, because low power consumption is the critical goal for the designing of such embedded system applications. They are basically used in portable devices due to its low power consumption and reasonable performance. That is consumption, MIPS per watt. Here MIPS stand for million instructions per second. So how much power has been consumed for the processing of the million instructions per second? That should be minimum. So this ARM basically provides the wattage is minimum. Power consumption should be minimum, na?
But this ratio should be maximum, because power consumed will be less, MIPS will be more. So overall this will be more. This ratio will be more, isn't it? Because this is power is in division.
Yeah, but here we can also have a million instructions per second. Per second and per watt. So per wattage consumption should be minimum. Right? That is why. So what is also important in this ARM processor is the thumb instruction set. Thumb instruction set. So besides its own instruction set, there is another instruction set, that is thumb instruction set. Right? Firstly, which was developed ARM processor was the ARM V6 version. The very first processor which was developed under the ARM corporation was your ARM V6 version. That was without the thumb instruction set. After that, your ARM 7 has been developed, and that is with TDMI architecture. Now, what is this TDMI? This is very important. Right? After this, ARM 7, ARM 9, ARM 11, and many more have been developed. And all those are with the TDMI architecture. So what is this TDMI? Here T stands for Thumb Instruction Set. D stands for Debug Interface. M stands for Hardware Multiplier, and I stand for Interrupts, that is Fast Interrupts. Okay. So this architecture provides this thumb instruction set, debug interface, hardware multiplier along with the fast interrupts. Okay. So debug interface is your nothing but your JTAG port, okay, which provides your ISP features, that is in-system programmable feature, that is the ability to reconfigure the functionality and behavior of the device. So 75% of all embedded applications, they are built around this processor. They are found in portable devices like PDA, mobile phones, media players, handheld gaming units, calculators, and many more. As I already told you, that ARM7 TDMI is thumb instruction set. T stands for debug interface, then hardware multiplier, fast interrupts. So this starts from the ARM7 version only. Various processor cores available are ARM6, that is V6, ARM7, 9, 10, 11. Extensions are thumb, and IP blocks which are available are UART, timers, and ADCs, and etc. So ARM architecture includes your following RISC features. The first is, that is your load and store architecture. Load and store architecture. Basically, what we have in the processor, we are having the pipelining architecture. So three-stage pipelined architecture. Is it clear? Three-stage pipelined architecture. The first step is the fetching, then decoding of the instruction, and then execution of those instructions. But when we are talking about the load and store architecture, this load and store architecture is available in ARM9, whereas ARM7 is with three-stage pipelined architecture only. Three-stage pipelined architecture, that is fetching, decoding, and execution. But your ARM9 is available with load and store architecture. So this is a five-stage pipelined architecture with these three main execution units, that is fetching, then decoding, and then execution. First of all, we have loading of this data from the main memory, then fetching, decoding, execution, and then storing of the data, right? Or we can also have in this five-stage pipelined architecture, that is ID unit, instruction fetching, IF unit. First of all, I have if unit, then instruction decode unit, instruction execute unit, then memory access, and then storing or buffering. So memory accessing, in this memory accessing unit, basically main memory will be accessed under the control of ID and IE, that is instruction decode unit and instruction execution unit. Whenever we want to access the main memory in order to have the data, this will be done under the control of these two units only, right? I will be explaining it in the diagram. Like here we are having ARM architecture is your 32-bit RISC processor core. Then here we are having 37 pieces of 32-bit integer register, 16 are available to the user. Pipelined architecture, as I have already told you, that ARM7 is three-stage pipelined architecture. ARM7 followed your von Neumann architecture, and ARM9 followed your Harvard architecture. So simple structure, reasonably your good power, speed, and power consumption is very good, right? Now ARM7 register set. As 16 registers are available, R0 to R15, R13 will be termed as stack pointer. What is the function of stack pointer? To store the address of the stack top, right? R14 is the subroutine link register. Subroutine link register basically stores the address where the subroutine starts, right? Then program counter stores the address of the instruction which is to be executed next. And then R16 is state register, CPSR, and current program state register. That is, it basically provide the address of the current instruction, right? So with use of this thumb instruction set, we are having 35% to 40% saving in the amount of memory compared to 32-bit instruction set. So whenever we have constrained environment in case of your memory, there we can have ARM7 type of processor as your main hardware processor. Extension enables simpler and significantly cheaper realization of the processor system. And such case instructions use only half of the memory rather than 32-bit instruction set. And ARM9 TDMI architecture, this ARM7 was old, and that is why they have been replaced with ARM9. arm 9 realizes the same instruction set as that of your arm 7. Pipeline length has been increased from 3 stages to 5 stages. And then also caches are separated. That is, different buses, different bus will be used for assessing the program memory and data memory, right? Another important feature is the condition code. That is, the execution of the instruction is optional, okay? Or is conditionally optional. So like here I have taken example, like if we want to compare the contents of the RI register with the RJ register, then we have set the condition that is not equal. If they are not equal, that is I contents are not equal to J contents, or if it is not equal, then it should be greater than or it should be less than, right? So instruction execution of every instruction is becoming optional, conditionally optional, right? Next important feature is the ability to fold, shift and rotate into the data processing itself. Like your arithmetical, logical, register to register move, this should be accomplished in one instruction only. As I have discussing about this statement, C statement, that is this statement, right? So this couldn't be rendered as a single word if we are dealing with ARM processor. That is, here what we can have, we can rotate or shift the content of this register, RJ register, by 2, then add that shifted contents with the accumulator register, and added result will be stored in the accumulator result, in the accumulator register, right? So this will be rendered as a single word. So next is your MIPS processor, that is microprocessor without interlocked pipeline structure. So MIPS basically is used for as a RISC microprocessor, that is reduced instruction set computer, and it is developed by MIPS Technologies. The early MIPS architecture was 32-bit implementation, rather the later versions were of 64-bit also. And as the case of ARM 7, ARM 9, ARM 11, we are having different variants of that processor. Similarly, in MIPS also we are having different versions of this MIPS processor, that is MIPS 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 32 and 64. So if we are talking about its brief history, in 1981 a team led by John L. Hensey at the Stanford University, and they have come across this MIPS processor. So they have, what they have dramatically used to increase, that is the speed lies in the, not in the instructions, but it is in the pipelining, right? So that is why they have eliminated the very useful instructions like multiply and divide, that is MUL and DIV instructions, so that every instruction should take the same number of clock cycle, right? So this is a 5 stages pipelined architecture. Here also you can see that we are having instruction fetch unit, instruction decode, execution, memory sense and write back. So whenever we want to assess, firstly the instructions will be fetched, then it will be decoded and executed, and after that the data which is required, the data which is to be required should be assessed from the main memory under the control of instruction decode and instruction execute unit. Here you can see, that is the memory assess unit, memory unit fetches data from the main memory under the control of these two units only, right? And write back unit, that is the, this unit is basically with the storing. So also this, your MIPS processor also followed your five stages pipelined architecture as a case of that ARM9 processor. Okay. Now, what are the, where are the main domains where we can have, where we can find this ARM MIPS processor? That is computer networking, telecommunications, video arcade games, computer printer, digital setup boxes, digital televisions, cable modems, and personal digital assistants. There we can have your MIPS type of processor. Okay. Now the third category is multimedia processor, MMX processor, Intel MMX processor. Intel MMX processor is basically, they were introduced in 1997 and they have built into Intel microprocessor compatible with x86 processors. And they are used for digital domain, that is for digital signal processing type of processors. And they are normally handled by the separate sound or video card. So they accelerate the multimedia and communication software. Also, they are used in audio, 2D and 3D graphics, video, speech synthesis, recognition for different applications where we want to synthesize the digital domain signals. There we can have your multimedia processor. So 57 new instructions has been introduced in multimedia type of processors. So they what is the main principle for this multimedia processor, or what is the main principle on which they are working? That is multimedia processor. That is the data parallel issue. Have you ever listened about the data parallel issues? For that, we are having four categories. That is SIMIT, MIMIT. Then we can have MIST and SIST. Now, what is this? That is single instruction multiple data. SIMIT stands for single instruction multiple data. This is multiple instruction multiple data, multiple instruction single data, single instruction single data. So these are some data parallel issues. And this multimedia processor, that is MMX, works on this technology, that is SIMIT technology. Single instruction will work upon multiple data. So different processing elements, processing units are incorporated in the main unit, and single instruction will work upon that multiple data. Like from this picture, you will be clear that this is the Intel microprocessor without MMX technology, and this is Intel microprocessor with MMX technology. So without, it will be working in a sequential order, right? Whereas when we are talking about the Intel microprocessor with MMX technology, it will be worked in parallel fashion. So eight bytes of data will be moved into the processor as one packed 64-bit value, than in a sequential order. So all will be processed at once by a single instruction only. Single instruction will be work upon multiple data. So here you can will be clear about this concept. Here we are having data pool, right? And another pool is consist of instructions. So here we are having processing unit. So your SIMIT technology, this single instruction will be fetched from the instruction pool, and that single instruction will be processed by the four processing units. And these processing units will are having parallel data, right? So single instruction will work upon number of data, multiple data, as in this case it is four. So this is, as I already told you. Also, it is clear from this picture that in SISID technology, single instruction will work upon single data, and the result will be also in a sequential order. Whereas in case of SIMIT, it will work on a multiple data, so result is also will be in parallelism. SIMIT, what is the difference between SIMIT and MIMIT processes? Here we are having, in this SIMIT architecture, we are having processing elements, and these processing elements should be globally controlled, right? Why they should be globally controlled? Because we are having single instruction will work upon multiple data. So that multiple data should be synchronized globally. Whereas in case of this MIMIT, here we are having processing element along with control unit, because here single, your multiple instruction will be work upon multiple data, so that each processing element will be available with your control unit, right? So highlights of this technology, that is multimedia processors, that they are working upon SIMIT technology. 57 new instructions will be introduced by this processor. 864 wide MMX registers are also, they are available in this type of processor, and new data types they have introduced. Advantages for using this MMX technology is that they have improved the processor performance in terms of your various speed, in case of your speed, then power consumption, right? And also they have been used in order to eliminate the requirement for DSP chips, right? They have introduced such type of Intel MMX processor. Now another important domain, major domain where we can deploy your embedded system, which is very much popular, is your WSN. That is, what do you mean by WSN?
Wireless
sensor network. That is, it is a basically a network which comprises of number of sensors, and these sensors are communicating over the wireless channel. Right? They are not connected through some wired media. They are communicating over the wireless technology. It may use your ZigBee technology, Bluetooth technology, or your Wi-Fi, WiMAX, depending upon the application. So wireless sensor network, in wireless sensor network, we are having a number of nodes, right? These nodes are nothing but their embedded system only. Right? So this node consists of four main parts. The first one is your
sensor node consists of four main parts, that is
Sensor node consists of these main four parts, that is sensor. It consists of a single sensor or an array of sensors depending upon the application. Then processor is required in order to process that sensed signal, right? Transceiver is required in order to transmit that process, that sensed and processed signal to some next node. And battery is required in order to provide the energy to these three units. So maximum power will be utilized by your transceiver unit. In order to transmit or receive the data, maximum power will be utilized. So we have to, being researchers, we have to keep this energy as minimum as possible. So we have to design MAC protocols or routing algorithms in such a manner that energy efficiency should be enhanced or network lifetime should be maximized, right? So in this picture, you can see that this wireless sensor network consists of number of sensor nodes, and these sensor nodes are nothing but their embedded system, intelligent embedded system only, because they are self-configured, right? These sensor nodes are connected with each other over the wireless channel, and at the edge of this sensor network, this sensing field, at the edge of this sensing field, we are having a gateway also, right? The function of the gateway is to collect the information from all these sensor nodes and pass this information to the base station, right? So such patch network are available over the sensing field, right? And the function of this sensing field is to collect the information, sensed information, depending upon the type of sensor it may using, temperature sensor, pressure sensor, so that whenever there is a change in that physical phenomena, that will be sensed by the sensor, processed by the by that sensor node, and that information will be transmitted to the next node, right? So these nodes are self-configured. They must develop this patch network by themselves only, by sending the hello messages to each other, right? So wireless sensor network is an infrastructure comprising of densely distributed nodes with spot sensing, which will be provided by the sensor only, then signal processing by the processor, embedded computation by the processor only, and then transmitted or connectivity will be provided by the transceiver. So whenever we talk about the embedded computing, embedded, what do you mean by embedded computation? That is the computation of the useful information which to be sent to the nearby node that should be sensed or computed by the node itself. So that node is nothing but that only an intelligent embedded system, because only that node has to take the decision whether they want to transmit this information or not, whether this information is useful or not to the next node or to the base station or to the gateway. Firstly, this information is sent to the gateway. From the gateway, the information will be further transmitted to the base station. So this is a wireless sensor network concept. Here we are having number of nodes. These nodes are interconnected with each other and then further will be connected to the gateway, and over the transit network they will be transmit that information to the base station. So transit network may be through the satellite also, satellite network. Here I have taken an example of forest fire detection. Whenever there is a firing in the forest, that should be detected. Whenever if we want to detect that fire in the forest, then we should incorporate wireless sensor network in the forest. Okay. So firstly, we deploy the sensor nodes with the help of helicopter, right? So those nodes will be scattered in this sensing field. And as these nodes are self-configured, so they will be interconnected with each other by sending the hello messages. Then whenever there is a increase, there should be some threshold value of the temperature. So suppose if it is 70 degrees Celsius, whenever the temperature rises above 70 degrees Celsius, it should be, that increase should be delivered to the base station from the source node to the base station by the nodes only. Right. So whenever the temperature increases, it should be delivered to the base station without any latency, without any delay, so that appropriate action should be taken by the user at the base station. So these sensor nodes, here you can see that these are the sensor nodes which are connected through each other, and here we are having a that is your gateway node. The gateway node transmits this information over the transit network to the base station. So various sensor nodes example available are Mika from the Polystyrene 3, Mika 2 from the Crossbow company, then from Berkeley SpecChip, and then Intel mode Club 04 type of node are available. These are the type of sensor node which is available in our lab also. That is from the Crossbow company. This is the smoke sensor, and this sensor node are available from the Crossbow company. So these sensor nodes are working based upon some technology. So here I am going to discuss about the Zigbee technology, that is 802.15.4 technology, which is used by this embedded sensor nodes. So 802.15.4 is your Zigbee technology. At the physical level, we are having data rates of up to 250 kilobits per second, 40 kilobit per second, 20 kilobit per second. They supports three data rates. Then star or peer-to-peer operation are feasible, and low power consumption. Whenever we require low power consumption, then such 802.15.4 technology can be incorporated. Also, it is whenever we have densely populated of sensor nodes, there also we can have this type of technology. So in this technology, beacons are transmitted by the by your main cluster head to the child nodes, right? So these beacons are nothing but the timing intervals which are timing slots which will be assigning to them. Then we are having contention assess period and contention free period. this is your active period and this is your inactive period. Means this is your wake up, when the node is your wake up, and this is when your node is in the sleep mode, right? So here we are having contention assess period, and this is your contention free period. During contention assess period, every node will be contained for the channel and there is a collision, right? And whenever we are talking about the contention free period, so guarantee time slots are there, right? So when guarantee time slots means that communication will be contention free, that is collision free, right? So guaranteed time slots will be assigned by the cluster head to their child nodes, so that there should not be any collision. Whenever collision will be occur, your energy will be consumed. Energy will be consumed, then again we have to retransmit the signal, we have to retransmit the frame, right? So here, this is ZigBee network configuration. Here in we are having ZigBee router, right? Then we are having ZigBee coordinator as a full function device, then as a reduced function device will be acting as their child nodes. Applications of embedded systems in WSN, wireless sensor network, that is for in order to monitoring the patient health, right? Then we can also deploy the wireless sensor network in the form of biomedical sensor network. Then in order to detect the physiological signals like ECG, respiratory rate, blood pressure, blood flow, glucose level, then we can use such type of sensor, right? In the form of band. This is another example, like positioning straps here. These are nothing but your embedded systems only. Positioning strap, panic button, fall detectors. Now such these sensors will detect any physical phenomena for which they have meant. So whenever this will active, then that information will be delivered directly to the doctor in the form of SMS or some call should be there, so that appropriate action should be taken. So this is all about the embedded systems and embedded processor and the domain where we can have embedded systems. So today we have learned about the embedded systems, then classification of embedded system, that is small scale, medium scale and sophisticated type of embedded system. Then we have talked about the concept of SoC under this embedded system only. Then we have come across embedded processors. Under embedded processor, we have discussed about ARM processor, then MIPS processor, multimedia processor, and the third one was a domain where we can have such type of processor, that is wireless sensor network. And in wireless sensor network, we have discussed about its architecture, then the sensor node detail, then the various type of sensor nodes available from the Crossbar from Polystrier company. Then the various real-time applications of this embedded systems in terms of your wireless sensor network. So thank you. Then.